Good evening and welcome. My name is Andrew Hudson. I'm the acting dean of the faculty in the absence of the dean, Daryl LeGrew, who's unfortunately overseas at this point in time. So I'm the closest thing we've got to a dean at this moment. So pardon me if I don't do the deanly things absolutely correctly. Friends, colleagues, students and visitors, welcome to this special lecture by Vicente Guallart. No, I knew I was going to. I tried harder. I did better the first time, I'm afraid.
But okay.
I apologise. Guillard. Guillard. That's it. Thank you. I'm sorry. The real dean would have got that right first time. This is the final Dean's Lecture for 2015. I'd like to acknowledge, before the lecture starts, the traditional owners of the land that we walk on and on which this lecture is taking place, the land of the Wurundjeri, and pay respect to their elders, past and present. It's my pleasure to introduce this lecture, which our guest, Vicente, will discuss future cities in light of the social, cultural and technological changes in which we are currently immersed. As a former chief architect for the city of Barcelona, Vicente was entrusted with developing the strategic vision for the transformation of the city. This topic, along also the title of a forthcoming book, is definitely pertinent in a time we're experiencing massive cultural and technological shifts. Vicente is known for his visionary and cutting-edge ideas around the urban habitats for the future. Professor Mark Burry, who is a professor of urban futures at our faculty and the MSD, will now take the opportunity, I hope, to say a few words and introduce our guest lecturer tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrew. And how gratifying to see a full hall. I suppose from my position of urban futures, and I have a connection with Barcelona, it's logical for me to be here. We're blessed with the generosity and spirit of a true visionary, which is how I see Vicente Guallart. He is a practitioner, he's an educator and publisher, and he's a public architect of first order, someone who's really interested in the governance of cities. My attention to Vicente's contribution should have started in the 1990s when I hadn't realised it was the same Vicente who was producing these extraordinary sort of animated renditions of some of the attributes of Antoni Gaudí. But that is what I could have noted. But what I did notice is when IAC, the Institute for Advanced Architecture of Catalonia, was founded in 2001, by Vicente. It's an extraordinary school. It's everything that most schools aren't. It's what a lot of students like to think that a school could be, which is a place that focuses on the pedagogy of learning through making in a very unpretentious environment. I'm hoping that Vicente will give us a bit of an indication. This year I had the honor of actually running a workshop there for 4 days, and I'm still humming from the experience. There were great students, great staff, and a great environment. My real interest in what Vicente is going to say today goes back to 1982, which is a bit of an admission, when I lodged my final thesis as a student called Visionary Ideals in a Capitalist Tradition. And what I did was started by looking and unpacking what was pretty well and not very well known, the great planning innovation from Ildefons Cerdà. And then I found that there was a whole wave of visionary activity all the way through with Le Corbusier and Sert, and then on with Boygas. There's just been these waves of stuff happening, which is what makes Barcelona the city that we all love. And I imagine most people in this room have been to Barcelona at least once. So I say welcome to Vicente. He is a visionary. I'm intrigued about what he's going to be doing next. He's had 5 years at the helm of Barcelona, taking it well into the 21st century. I think he's going to give us some aspirational indications of what we ourselves might strive for. So, Vicente.
So, Mark, I am impressed by your words, and I'm impressed by this auditorium. So first of all, I would like to thanks to Tom. Now we are starting with the names. Kevan and Mark. Tom and Mark came to Barcelona last March, and we were talking, and they decided to invite me to come here, and I have spent already 4 or 5 days that has been amazing. I had the opportunity to know about Melbourne with Don, that is a master on explaining how the city works and walking around looking for any arcades. And I had the chance also to talk with Justina Gideon and Dan Law. And I had a great experience talking with the people, looking around the building, etc. Thanks, Andrew. We'll try to repeat my name many times later. Today, in fact, I quit my position at the City Council like 3 months ago. And I think it's the first lecture I give in a, let's say, big school of architecture. And today I would like somehow to review the 3 layers of my work, that in fact the first one, that is more the architect as a practitioner, will be very much connected with the students' things that architects should be doing, that is making design and then building it. The second layer is more connected with the education and what I did and what I am doing at the IAC, more connected with the school is doing. And then the third layer will be related with my work as chief architect, that we had the opportunity, I think that still that is a miracle that I was appointed chief architect. I will explain you, but I had the opportunity to run the city, to work with the mayor and with many people in the city in order to define the future of Barcelona. So let's go ahead. It will be a kind of, there will be many images, so don't worry. If you are bored, you can disconnect and maybe reconnect later. There will be kind of 3 different lectures, as I say, in one first lecture. So I will be talking, the first part of my lecture will be my work as an architect. That's how I need to quit when I was working for the city, and then I close the office and I will be reopening again. But one of the, I think the best buildings that I never built, and I hope I will find the place to build it, were connected with this idea that if architecture is landscape, then buildings are mountains. So I was writing, publishing as a young architect, and then I was looking for drawings, ideas, initiatives, new strategies for the world to come. This was like the 90s. I found these incredible drawings by Violet Leduc, one of the fathers, in fact, of Gaudi, and he wrote that good could not invent mountains without geometry. So behind any kind of complex form that we can discover or we can imagine, we have always some rules, some geometrical rules. And part of my work has been dealing with these rules and trying to, let's say, to transform into architecture. So I wrote some articles about this idea of making architecture as mountains. And then one day I received a phone call from a mayor, and he told me, "Hey, Mr. Guallart, would you like to build a mountain for me?" So I couldn't believe it, but it was true. So he had a problem because he had that query here. So this is Denia, is a city in the south of Valencia. This was the mountain where the city was created. So the Muslims make a city here, then the Christians attack the Muslims, then another Christians attack the other Christians. And so everyone was fighting here, and someday they sold out the mountain in order to make the harbor, and they somehow make it this huge hole. No? So it was a kind of magical moment where it shows that anything is possible, even to make the real possible, to find a client that is asking you to make a mountain. And then, well, this could be a long story, but I will show some few images where, in fact, this was the main concept, the idea of rebuilding the mountain looking to from the geometry of the limestone and the way the limestone works. And then we were working, this was my first 3D printing using stereolithographic technologies, that is a kind of laser working on resins. And then we developed this idea and with this project, the idea that you can make a building that you can walk on it, and then you can enter to different levels of the interior that had a commercial area, hotel, auditorium, and many other things. So some years later, I make another project, in this case for the expo in Broslak. So I, you know that every time they make an expo, they make a competition to win the expo. There were different cities competing. So I won the competition, but they lose the competition. So Broslak didn't want the competition to organize the expo. And then I have an incredible, let's say, project, the idea again of making a mountain, the idea that instead vertical buildings, we could make kind of fat buildings, big buildings with many functions, again, with some kind of organizations. And then the question was how to, in some moment we decide to make a model, how to transform this geometry that can be, I mean, with, from a render is easy, but when you try to build really the model, then it's much more complex. So we were working on this, the idea of making facades that are able to capture sun and then produce energy. And then we were working on this building that at the end was dealing with some complex geometry, but we were able to fabricate the model. I have been also working in projects that have been built. So this was another opportunity in the south of Barcelona where we have this rocky shore, and then there was a competition, and my proposal was to make some kind of artificial islands that were something in between furniture and public space. So I had the chance to work with these modules in that case that we were able to produce and create these surfaces that are bigger than a chair, but smaller than a square, no? And the people is happy looking to the beach, etc. I did another project in this case, working with the idea. This is, I think, the biggest parametric design built in Spain, maybe, because in this case we were really dealing with the idea of having this unit, this kind of umbrella. I have been always interested about these structures that where the structure and the building is the same thing. And then in this case, we needed to find the people with the right tools in order to be able to cut all these different pieces that all of them are the same, but all of them are different. So we were able to make this real, and we fabricate this pavilion in the also in the coast of Valencia. And then I won two competitions in Taiwan. So I has been flying many times to this side of the world, a little bit northern. But this is the harbor of Fuji, where at that moment we're working with the idea of making a bioclimatic structure, because the humidity is so high. What we try in this competition is to look for, let's say, accelerate the wind in order to improve the to create a good let's say sensation for the environment. So I was working many years, and to work in China sometimes it is very complex, and we were trying to learn about how to make another kind of architecture that was not cues, were not formed, were not whatever. And then we were looking for interacting as much as we could with the local conditions using the tools that we had in front of us. So again, nearly I resigned, but at the end it was built. So it was, I went like 3 years ago and I saw the building that was built. The quality is not exceptional, but at least we proved that we could do such a surface and with these metallic structures. And I make this fish market that was great. And then the other project I did in Taiwan was to extend So you see, I destroy 1 hectare of the China Sea. We occupy the sea because you see that they have the highway that is running from the waterfront, and then they wanted, maybe they saw some magazines and they saw, oh, there is something called public space. We would like to be able to walk in the street, and then that's why I make a proposal, and well, they came to Barcelona, many Chinese people, and said, yeah, that's the public space. I remember saying to the minister, I would like to make all the pavement with wood. And he told me, you know what the people here make with wood? They make barbecue. And I say, oh, minister, don't worry. The people will take care, it will be fantastic. And yeah, it's true. I mean, the people is smarter sometimes than the politicians. But it has been a fantastic experience also to work with some complex geometry. In this case, we're doing parametric rocks based on some small landscape that I discovered in this volcanic island. And then what we did was to write kilo. So when the boats are coming to the city, you can read the name of the city. And then those letters are transformed into benches. So again, I have good partners there, and it was possible to make this place, and the people is enjoying, etc. And the last, no, two more projects, one in Valencia. Someone told me about Sociopolis. This was a project I initiated many, like 12 years ago. I invite many architects, 16 architects, to do a project, to do a neighborhood together. This was when the economy was going very well. But we decided to keep, you see, the agriculture in the center of the neighborhood and to try to reinvent urbanity without urban form. I wanted to keep this landscape, agriculture landscape, in the interior of the city, not as a kind of recycling existing landscape, but as something that we decide to build and to create, etc. So those were the images we're making at that moment, and this is the result. So we were really able to do the biggest urban agriculture piece in Europe, I think, made from scratch. In this case, creating also the traditional irrigation system with the channels. So instead to spend so much money on asphalting the streets and making asphalt, we try to generate this landscape that where every building will be able, every window was looking to this place. We didn't make a golf court, we did an agriculture court, as you can see. And then the other project, I was working on the idea of the sharing housing, the idea of how we could apply the Napster model or the idea of sharing to the physical space. And then we developed this concept of if you want to make 100 apartments, instead to have 100 separate apartments, you can share 20% of your surface, and then basically one student will pay for 45 square meters, but he will get 408 that you can see here, 400 a day. So you have 36 for yourself, 72 that you share with 12 people, and then 300 that you share with all the students. So the result is these spaces that are individual spaces like a small loft. This is the sharing space where when you come from the elevator, you enter to this space, and then from here you can enter to your individual room, as you can see here. And the interesting thing is that when you put people together, something happens. In this case, we put people together and they discover each other, that one had a guitar, the other had a battery, drums, and the other had a piano. And this building has three bands of rock. Because when the people interact, something happens. And this is what happened here in Valencia. So this is the plans. You see here the sharing space, elevators, sharing space, and then the individual space for everyone. So it's another kind of community where it's not exactly the idea of small units, private units, or public spaces. This is literally a sharing space. And we're developing the facade using a cellular automaton, but this will be, I have incredible people working with me that they draw using Excel. This is something absolutely amazing, no? I used to draw by hand or with AutoCAD, but now to draw with Excel, as Mark is doing sometimes, is absolutely great. So second step, I will talk a little bit about IAC, and I will talk about the dream of a generation of young architects, in my case, that I came to Barcelona to work for someone for the Olympic Games. But then what we discovered after Olympic Games, that it was everything so success, the School of Architecture was completely full and blocked, so that we were not accepted to enter as professor, assistants, or anything. And then we were inspired by people like Cerdà in that case. Cerdà is the person that, in fact, he was born in a farm. He studied engineer, but he never got a commission to design the master plan of Barcelona. So that's amazing, no? How come someone that never can, he decided, because his two brothers died, and then he decided to use all his money in order to invent a new science in order to improve the quality of life of people. This science was called urbanism. And he wrote the theory, general theory of urbanization. In 2 years will be 150th anniversary. And by the way, he developed the master plan. He only got a commission to make a topographical map, but then he decided to make a master plan, and then he had some political connections in Madrid, and he was able to get approved. And then we were lucky because in Barcelona we have this tradition of inventing the city of the future. We have another tradition that is to have many good architecture for many different moments of the history. We have different urban patterns, like little bit Roman city like Florence, Paris, and New York, and with buildings from the Roman, Renaissance, etc., until today. So that means that we want to fill this line, and then we need to work for the future. I'm interested in mathematics, and I discovered this pattern where every 25 years there is a new generation of architects that are able to be connected to the world, and then they try to renew the ideas about architecture. And after the School of Barcelona, we were looking around and we didn't see anyone, and we thought that we should fill that space. We should really try to bring our ideas. We're talking about digital technologies, and the School of Barcelona, they told us, digital technology? You say digital? Well, we thought that, or we were very stupid or very smart. There were only two options, and we took the risk of trying not to be too stupid, let's say. And that's why we said, well, we should start to collaborate with people in order to invent the city of the future. We should learn from the ecology, but also to work with the digital technologies. And then we wrote that book, the Metropolis Dictionary of Advanced Architecture. And we say that advanced architecture is to digital age what modern architecture was to industrial age. So every time that you have a new architecture, there is a new vocabulary, new ideas. And this is what we try to do, to frame with that book, with many people contributing to it. And then we did our first project. We created a master program with the Polytechnic University, and then we start to work with Media Lab on what today is called the Internet of Things. We were working with Neil Hassenfield, that was working with things that think. And then today, all of these that we are doing, trying to make an intelligent space using distributed computation, is what many people is trying to do with these digital technologies. We also start, the second big project was about the territory. So what we were doing was to move from talking about data and information, etc., and starting to talk about the territory, starting to talk about Catalonia. In this case, we made this big research, and then that's why we were making drawings like this. And in fact, I was doing drawings like this for Barcelona. It's strange that no one in my period as chief architect took those images and say, are you crazy or what? No. But this is what I was drawing when I was in the year 2003, and the main concept here was the idea of the renaturalization. So the city has been growing against the nature during 2000 years, and now the nature was attacking the city, was trying to go back, and then was creating these artificial islands or trying to densify the city. That this drawing has a lot of meaning on this idea of densify the city center, as you are doing here in Melbourne, and also reintroducing the nature. But then that's why we create YAC was placed here in this industrial area of Barcelona. And what we thought is that more than to be in a studio mode, we would like to be in a laboratory mode. We would like to be in a place where to draw and to fabricate will happen in the same space. So that means that we didn't have, from the beginning, the first day we decided that we should learn by doing. We should be learning by fabricating and by making things, by testing ourselves different things. And that's why we rent this big space, we start to buy machines, but we were also interested about the idea of working as a community. This is what I say always to my students. This is a democracy, we work together, let's see what we can do together. And this is what we have been trying to be to do always, this idea of working together. We also have been always interested on how new technologies can produce new systems of construction. Those are some of our students that are making mini-bots that are able to build something that is bigger than themselves, that they are able to grow on the building that they are making. And well, in the Institute we have many lectures, etc. And also we were collaborating with a network of Fab Labs. We were helping very much our friends from MIT to create this idea of the laboratories of fabrication where everyone in any place in the planet should be able to make anything by sharing knowledge and using the local resources. So somehow this was the beginning of the idea of the self-sufficient city. The idea that you are producing things, but you are able to produce things because you are connected to the world. Right now there are more than 550 laboratories around the world, and we run an educational program called Fab Academy, where the different labs are connecting at some moment, and then we work in a distributed mode. No? We're producing many books, etc. And I make a very interesting, I think, installation in the Venice Biennale on the idea of developing this internet of everything and growing to the infinite. The people from Google, they say, we wanted to download the physical, to download internet to a computer. And then here, what we say is we would like to think how to organize the physical world as if everything that we have in the physical world will have a digital identity. And then it will be long to explain, but we're talking about this multi-scalar approach about describing how a city works. We're thinking in those diagrams on moving from a centralized model, from you see here, there, a nuclear plant in the line of the energy. In general, we have today in the industrial economy, few places that produce things and many people that consume things. But if we think in the third dimension, what will happen is that many people connected, making many things, could be equivalent to few people making things. So it's the difference between television and YouTube. Many people making things and sharing things through internet. So we make this installation that was at that time the biggest installation ever done on the Internet of Things, and those are the IAC students that they, in parallel to be a student, they try to be in the fashion mode. And so we organize some sessions of pictures. This is Areti, that Areti today is the academical director of IAC here. So we make that installation, and then the other, we were always doing projects. The other big project we did was we participated in the solar decathlon, and we decided to fabricate, to make the first solar house made in Barcelona. And we were working, fabricating everything in our laboratory. And the result was this. We make a kind of building that was elevated from the ground. The experience was absolutely fantastic. We got the award, the first prize from the public. And we got the last award from the jury's decision. So we were never very good on academics, and that's why, but the people sometimes, they love us. So we made this wooden house and these flexible, the most efficient solar panels here. And then this is the interior that, again, the students were acting as models. So we in Barcelona, we make another house, that a prototype of another house. And this was for the Smart City Expo in 2011, where we design and fabricate this house as a kind of one slab of one potential building that could fabricate energy. So we are working again with the students, working very fast in order to try to describe a new way to introduce the solar production in the facades of the building, going beyond the idea that a solar building is a regular building with solar panels in the roof. So we should try to invent what means a solar building and how it works. And we were working also with, in this case, with Daniel Ibáñez and Rodrigo. They were developing this pavilion, also made very fast, in this case using passive technologies. So after all this experience, publishing many books, etc., I decided to write an essay called The Self-Sufficient City, where I was trying to define, the people start to talk about the smart cities, how technologies will change the world. And then the question is not about the technology, it's about what you want to do with it. And then my argument is that in the future, we are moving to a future like this, where in fact, the people should be in the center of any decision, any organization. We should try to empower the people, the citizens, and the citizens should be able to make everything in their environment. And what means everything that they need to live means energy, food, and things. We need to produce food for us to get energy, energy for our environment and for the system, and then to produce things that we need to live. And we'll be able to do this if we are connected globally with networks of information, social, economical, and knowledge networks. So if you are able to develop a model like this for yourself or for your city, then the world that we are creating is this. It's a world based on the networks, on the idea of creating collaborative networks that we are able to fabricate something that is bigger than ourselves. So that's the basic principle for the self-sufficient city. But once you say this, obviously you need to take decisions, to deploy technologies, to have an organization that is to supporting the development. And what happened many times is that architecture and urbanism, we don't have a proper science. We, in general, and I discovered this working for the city of Barcelona, we try to copy from each other. We try to learn what they do, but we don't learn very much. If you ask a doctor in Melbourne or Barcelona to describe the human body, he will open the book, or maybe he, if he's smart, he will remember all the muscles or bones or the blood system. And they will describe, he will describe the same exactly. And then once you are able to describe the anatomy, the physiology, etc., and to create a science out of it, you can talk about how to use information in order to deal with the DNA and how to recreate it somehow. But what happened with the cities is that if we ask to any architect from Melbourne and Barcelona to describe the city, each of us will say something completely different. When you ask someone, tell me what is your city, how it works, the most important thing, the people say, the economy, the tourism, the energy, and the transportation, and the housing. But there is a kind of, you can look at this, someone talking about the smart cities making diagrams always has colors, the diagrams, and then you see that there are some names, and you say, oh, yeah, it looks like a city. But then if you try to understand, it's like talking about my hair, my blood pressure and the muscle and the speed that I run. Those are completely different categories of things, and it's very difficult to do something, to talk about biomedicine if you don't describe properly what you do about your body. So that's why we were working, I mean, it took like 10 years to make this diagram in order to be able to describe the anatomy of any city in the world, in any kind of development, in any kind of moment of their history. And then based on the city described, that somehow is putting together Cerdá and the theories of the ecology. We deal with the physical world, with the human beings, and the information that we generate in between. And then what are today the so-called smart cities, in fact, is the capacity that we have in order to manage the information that we are over able somehow to concentrate and to analyze and to manipulate. And we are able to interact with any different scale in the city, in the infrastructures, or in the environment. This diagram was absolutely fundamental in order to define also the structure of our department. When I was chief architect of Barcelona, before the city in general is organized like silos. Everyone wants to have their own budget and responsibility. And that's why the people from the environment that in general they are biologists or whatever, so they don't want to talk with architects because they destroy everything, no? So the one were killing the others. And that's why in some moment the ecology was more important than the architecture. And there is this always this tension. But in order to clarify the tension, always there is an engineer that show up. I say, hey, I am the engineer. Forget about everything. I will put order here, I will make a road, and I will put a line, power line underground. No? So, and then, but now there are more smarter people. I say, yeah, you are over. I am an IT guy. I can do an app, and I can destroy all you. No? So the question is, how you put together all these four different figures, the biologists, the engineers, the architects, and the IT guys. So we call this urban habitat, the idea that we are creating something bigger than urban is, the idea that we are dealing with a reality that is almost already built, and then based on that, this map has been fundamental to do many things in the city. So I would like to show in the exhibition up there, you will see like the different layers that we were working in one hand on more, let's say the policies related with the different layers like energy, water, mobility, information, etc. And in the other hand, how we grounded the different policies on specific projects in the city. I will explain some of the projects here that can show what we have been trying to do. But first, I will talk about one place that, in fact, is the last thing I did when I was running, was director of IAC, that was to buy a property, the IAC, the kind of old factories here. But we bought a big area in a natural park because we wanted to create a laboratory where we could experiment. So the place is this one. The place is this one. Yeah, here you see the city here, where we can experiment in real time with things. I am always interested about the idea of the self-sufficiency. If we want to be self-sufficient, we need to control, and we need to have knowledge about everything that we do, where this plastic is coming from, where this paper is coming from, where the water is coming from. And then in some cases, we'll start to understand, we will see that if this plastic is coming from, let's say, Brazil or Egypt, because it's very cheap, and is using oil from the Middle East, we are stupid on drinking water in something that contains so many petrol and is part of another system. We'll be thinking on taking this bottle in a machine and then recycling it and then to do another thing out of this bottle. That, in fact, is what we are trying to do in many cases. So in Baidaura, that is the name of the place, we are trying, as you are doing here, that every tree has a name or a number. You have a project like this here in Melbourne. We're trying to do this, but because I wanted to have a very precise traceability between the tree, the wood, how much energy we put on something, then we're painting the wood in order to be able to follow which tree was generating which wood. And then at the end, we were in the laboratory that we have there. We're able to make a chair that was directly coming from some tree. So we know who is the father and who is the son. The father is the tree, the son is the chair that is here, and the chair is having a fantastic life, as you can see. In Baidaura, we are also discussing, and we were doing this diagram before anyone was talking about the circular economy. But the idea is, if we are self-sufficient, we should be able to take everything coming from the nature, to use part of the tree to make a chair, but also to make energy, and then to use the water in order to have like different technologies and solutions. So we're working with the biggest power company on the what we call the Internet of Energy, the idea that every building should be able to produce energy, to consume it, and to store it in batteries or in the car, and if the heat it don't use it, to share with someone around, and or if not, to sell to the network. So this diagram explains how you can apply networks to energy, and this is something is going to happen for sure. In Spain, and this is one problem that maybe some other countries has, this drawing is almost illegal, because the government decide that if the people will be able to produce the energy and to charge their car, this will be the revolution, because the people will be free. They could be disconnected from the oil coming from the Middle East, no? The oil from the Middle East is something incredible. So in Barcelona or in Spain, we buy the oil from them. So with the oil, we heat the planet. We make a bank transfer, and with that money, they sponsor the T-shirt of the Barcelona Football Club, no? So it's something that it doesn't make sense at all. What it makes sense is that if we can disconnect ourselves to this kind of structure, that the wars around the world are always about energy, if we're able to do this, then this will be the revolution. But this is the revolution is going to happen. There are many people already, I mean, in California, Tesla, the guy that made the Tesla electrical car now is making batteries, and there will be more political borders or problems in order to develop new principles, because in fact it's changing the politics in the world. It's changing, it's empowering the people and empowering the cities, as I say. So the self-sufficient city is a revolution. But in fact there are only, someone say there are only two solutions, or the self-sufficient city or Blade Runner. You know, is the kind of chaos, dark, the more oil and everything complex, etc. Or we empower the people and we create more freedom everywhere. So we were developing this micro server. Remember what we did in 2001 with MIT. So 12 years later, we did it with Endesa in order to put one of these servers or computers in any electrical element in that old house. And we were working on the idea of the Internet of Water too, on the idea of having like different qualities of water storing in the different qualities. It's like your computer will have different hard drives, and then depending on the kind of information, for example, if it has virus, if the, let's say information can have a virus, you have a hard drive. If it's very clean information, and if it's open to everyone, you have another hard drive. So this is the different qualities of water, from clean water to black water, and then the idea of how to reuse all of these in relation to buildings. Then the interesting thing or the miracle is that we were dealing with all these crazy ideas with our students. We produce a model, a huge model, as big, maybe as big as this wall. Well, half, okay. But every group of the 60 students were making their own part of Barcelona, and then we were presenting the campaign in the year 2011 with this mayor, that is Mayor Trias. So we were crazy enough to think about how to explain to the people what were the new ideas, and then we created these windows that every day during the campaign, the mayor was opening the window and then confronting the reality. You see the city there, the train station there that has some problems with an idea of what to make on it, or the mountain, the hill, the idea of the renaturalization, or the idea of bringing MIT and Fab Lab not to the richest part of the city, but to the poorest part of the city, in order to, again, to empower people, to promote that instead to complain about the unemployment, they could learn how to invent their own job. So I remember I myself was crying the day of the opening of the session for the mayor, because what he was saying is, we will make a self-sufficient city made of productive neighborhoods at human speed inside a hyper-connected metropolis. So he absolutely was declared that the mantra that we were working in the last 10 years will be the mantra for the city of Barcelona, and this is what we have been trying to do in the last years. So sometimes we were more successful than others, but the truth is that Barcelona has a long history, and then we were defining with different moments. So here was Cerdà with the urbanists, and here was the forum that somehow was the end of a period, was disaster. We're defining the future for the next 40 years, and we are moving from here, from this idea of the centralized production of anything, food, energy, and products, to this decentralized model, bringing also the idea of the retrofitting with the city, connecting the solar buildings with electrical cars, etc. No? And then creating this other layer. This is the new layer we are adding the city, the metabolism. The idea that the cities are not only consuming what someone else is producing, but the idea that we are integrating this. And this new layer is a great opportunity to architects, because somehow architects and design is important again. Design is not about to make the most strange building you can do that is moving around and is trying to look to the right position. This was the fall of Lehman Brothers, no? So if you see someone trying to do this, take care. It will be very expensive, it will be very strange, and will be for their glory and not the glory of the people, of the citizens. So that's why the challenge is not to look for this strange form, it's about to look for the rationality of introducing new elements like the potential of producing energy, managing water, connecting with information, having real-time information in order to define your city. And that's why, in my case, you see Barcelona is already built with a mountain, the two rivers, and then the waterfront. And the drawing that was, when I arrived to the city, was the drawing made by Oriol Boigas in the 90s with the highway and the city that somehow was growing from the center to the periphery. In fact, they said we need to reform the center and monumentalize the periphery. And now the people from the periphery say, hey, I don't want to be the periphery of anyone. Eh? Don't come with me as be your periphery. If you want to be the center, it's okay, but don't tell me I am the periphery. And about monuments, we have our own monuments. No, but you don't have a sculpture of some, we have an old bridge of a water house making the beginning of the century. That's our monument, don't touch it. So you know, this discussion about center and periphery is somehow is over. We should rethink, and this is what we are trying to do here. And then I was trying to make new drawings and new layers about, in this case, the mountain, the two rivers, the waterfront. So to define new crucial elements that in fact, in many cases, they were not in the agenda of the people, in order to see how the city of the future will look like. So in order to make this drawing costs like 4 billion, let's say. It will take like 30 years to be there. The idea of having, you will see now, many of those projects. But the question is, you need to have a long-term plan, and also you need to have a drawing that you can share. So the revolution, you make revolutions only with one paper and some text that someone can read, or one drawing that is a map of the future. You need to have a vision in order to make a big transformation, and this is what the cities need, to have a vision and to share with everyone in order to build the future. So that was the mantra, as I say, that we printed in boards and we distributed all over the different rooms in the city council. And the most revolutionary question, in fact, is this idea of building again neighborhoods. So in general, we live, yeah, sorry, so this is the right diagram. So the traditional city is like that, centralized model. Then we, after the city was so big, we start to decentralize, or we have the distributed model. There are two kinds of centralized cities, Moscow or Beijing, where you have a center, and those are the two more collapsed cities in the world, because the city has been growing, trying always to have the reference to the center, and then it's impossible to move back and forth. And there is another model that could say is the American model, where you have the downtown and the suburbs, where it's very clear what is the downtown and where it's very clear what are the suburbs. In cities as big as very big, like LA, they start to develop the second model. They say, well, that's too big. We should do something. And then they start to create kind of mini downtowns in order to organize economical activity, offices, or shopping malls, etc. This is great. But this is not internet. So the first one is the industrial by manual. This is the industrial city. And the second one is the upgrade of the industrial city. The city for the information age is this one. It's the idea where you have a big system, you break in parts, and then you reconnect it. But the question is, what are these small parts that should be like perfect places to live, and then to reconnect them? This is called neighborhood. So this is called community, something that we invented in the past. It's connected with the idea that the people can walk to work. Those are the diagrams of all the public facilities that the people need. A market, well, here is the diagram. So the different ages, the different functions, and then the different facilities that you need to have around you. If you are able to walk to all these places, and even if you are able to walk to work, you are done. You have the best city in the world. And the important thing is that this should happen everywhere, not only in the center or in some special places. So the only way to have a city like Mumbai with 20 million people, with something that makes sense, something that is not transformed into Blade Runner, is to make something like this, is to break in parts and then to reconnect it, to be able to do something like this, to have these units of 500 meters and then to reconnect all of this. So this is the drawing. The interesting thing is that Barcelona used to be a more central area with a periphery, but then 25 years ago, someone said, we should start to decentralize, and after that, to create this identity in the neighborhood and to develop this distributed model. And in fact, I start to make those drawings to discover and to recognize that this is already existing. In Barcelona, we don't have a central library, a city library that should pay by the government. And we don't have a national library because for the moment, just for the moment, we are not an independent country. But the question is that what we have been doing, and we are very good, is on making, let's say, small units of areas of neighborhoods where the people can walk to the library, or the people can go to the health center, or the people can go to the markets. So with the markets, last year I met your Lord Deputy Mayor, Ms. Riley. Today we were talking with her because you have a project of market and trying to rediscover and transform your public market. So what we have been doing is using those markets in order to create the identity of the neighborhoods, in order to promote that the people can walk to buy fresh food, or the people can go, in this case, every market we try to upgrade, not only to make a rehabilitation, but somehow to make an upgrade. And in this case, we introduce also some restaurant. Or in this one, that is an old market made in the 19th century, we knew that, you see, it's a full block of the grid of Barcelona. We know that underground there was the existing old walls, and then what we did was to make a building system that allowed to recover these walls and to let the people to walk into this historical area. Or this other project where we are in near the mountains, and then what we did was to create, this is the new market that is under the renewal now, we are making the big agriculture roof in Spain right now. We are developing this idea of having the roof, the agriculture on top of the market. Or this one that was part of the transformation of the center of Plaza de las Glorias, that in fact is a free market where, I mean, the people can walk and can move around, etc. No, so we put a lot of effort in markets because those can transfer the identities. But you can see all these different facilities where if you see that, well, here you don't have something, a library or health center, you know you should do it in order to make every place in the city accessible to everyone. Another crucial question is also to define the vision and to define centralities. So in Barcelona, we were the last, I always say to the, especially to the Indian cities, that in general, the cities try to copy each other, and we are very good on repeating the same mistakes to each other. So look about China. They copy exactly everything wrong that we did in the past. And now what they are going to do will be to do what we had been doing in the past, that is to do a regeneration of our cities. But India still has the opportunity, and I will bet that they will be making the same mistakes. The last big mistake that made Barcelona, because we did some mistakes, we are proud of it, was to build a kind of highway here in Plaza de las Glorias, in the what should be the center of the city. Cerdà thought that this should be the center, but someone in the 90s, they copied this ride, park and ride model from America. If you read the wrong book, you are done. I mean, you can destroy you can destroy your city. So take care. And then here, someone, I mean, during 25 years, was kind of destroying the city. And then the question was that we say, no, we should make a tunnel, we should make a green area. This is part of this kind of diagonal, so we should do something. And then, we invest $100 million in building, in making the construction of this road. And we invest, in fact, last year, $20 million in order to demolish it. That's true. So I say the Indian city, hey, you could save $120 million, go directly to the park. So don't waste your money and don't waste 25 years of your kids, no? And this is what we did. So we demolished the highway, and also we learned how to make a temporary use of this space. What is funny is that some political groups that were in the government were developing this idea when they were in the opposition. They didn't want to demolish it. So, and we were able only to do because the citizens, they say, we should do it. So there is always this question about how we deal with between the participation and the citizen implication and the architects, because sometimes some people say, well, the architects, they are too whatever. And then some people say that architects, we should be drawing exactly what the citizens are saying. What I think that obviously this is very dangerous. So this is a big debate because more and more the information is flowing around, the people are more organized, and then this is an important question for the architects in the future. If we demolish the roads and we develop more public transportation, we develop sharing space, then what happens is that we can extend the sidewalks. So suddenly, some area that the city that was occupied by cars start to be occupied by people. And then in the last 4 years, we transformed four major avenues with this kind of idea of extending the sidewalks, because the diagram for Barcelona is at 30%, 31% walk to work, 10% use the bus, etc. So there are few people using the private car. My son doesn't want to buy a car. I say to the Indian student, don't buy a car. But they look at me and say, eh. We are going to contaminate our share of the planet. You did it before, we want to do it too. So this is something is going to happen, but from the economical, remember about the internet of mobility, etc., the idea of mobility as a service, the idea of having electrical buses, etc., we will not need this idea of having their own car in the future. That's why we are developing projects like this. This is the bus system of Barcelona. You see, it's impossible to understand the bus system. So they start to make lines because the city was growing, someone make a line, the people were happy and everything. So I never take the bus in Barcelona. One day I took the bus and I was lost. And I decided not to take it again, that's the truth. And then, but the question was that using data, the people, we had very good people. In fact, they were ecologists that were thinking how to make a city, a bus network as a grid. If Barcelona is a grid, why don't we make a system where we have vertical lines, horizontal lines, and that's all. So this is the plan we are developing right now. The major problem is not technological, it's social. Because in the past, in the former model, there was one old woman that was always taking the same bus during 35 years, and the driver was the same. So somehow they were part of a kind of family, and it was very difficult to say, now we are creating a new system for you. It will be better, you will be changing the bus, it will be perfect, it will be agreed, you will understand it. The question is social and is not, let's say, technological. Now we did 50% of the model, and in the next year we'll finish it. We want to move from that model of having the city 50-50 for cars and for people to move to these more 70-30, trying to extend the center. So the idea that we have a center, a periphery, again, is over. We have a city that is It has different forms, but in any case, you need really to try to make only one project for the whole city. So that's why information is so important, and that's why we have been trying to create a system in order to put to have information as a public infrastructure in the same way that we have light, water, the trees, or the street. The street, we have a street, we have lights. Why don't we have Wi-Fi for free in the street? And we have a system that can collect any kind of information. And this is what we did, merging engineers and IT guys. And well, you can see here, we developed this concept of this cylinder that was able to hold all these Wi-Fi and everything in this light post. You see one here and another here. We develop a prototype near Melbourne, and now we are extending all over the city. It will take another 20 years or 25 years, but we'll have information as a kind of civic right. Every sensor that we put will be attached to this, and then this is a platform that in the future will get drones or will get whatever. And then I don't like to talk about the smart cities, and this is Fortune, this month of August, they say Barcelona, the most wired city in the world. And they are explaining how these people are taking pictures to Camballo, and then they are sending, uploading to Twitter using this system. So the idea that information as a public infrastructure will generate new service in the cities. We are also working with the idea of having one fab lab per district, the idea to dissolve IAC into the city, to bring innovation as a civic right everywhere, and that's why we are creating these laboratories of fabrication everywhere, and we are creating so many events for people developing the future car that will not make in a factory, but will be made by young people making their own car. And then in order to share the vision, what we have been trying to do, what we are trying to do, and this is what I am trying to do right now, is to try to develop more science, trying to develop more scientific knowledge about cities in order to be able to learn from each other and to take the right decisions. So we are trying to map all the urban fabrics around the world in order to be able to compare the potentials of those fabrics. But there are no good cities and bad cities. Everything is a city. So this is maybe Nuamchot or Medellin, this kind of self-constructive city. This is a city where the people live. We should include in our broader vision about all the urban fabrics in the world. This is Nuamchot in Mauritania. So the idea that we should have a broader knowledge about what means a city, what the systems contain in the city, how to create centrality or not centrality, where to put the money in order to manage the city. There was another magical moment in 2014 during the meeting of the Fab 10 with MIT and with the city of Barcelona, with the mayor. We asked the mayor, this person, Neil Hersenfield, he asked the mayor, if he would like to be self-sufficient, Barcelona would like to be self-sufficient in 40 years. So, and if he would like to become self-sufficient, if he would like to have a long-term challenge, he should press a red button. He did it. He pressed the button. And now there is a web page with a countdown. The web page is fabcity.cc, where you can see all the fab labs around the world and different cities that are already joined to the initiative in order to develop, let's say, knowledge, technology, solutions to push each other, to help each other in order to develop this vision. So that's all. That's my vision, my short story. What I'm thinking now is, after these three layers of knowledge, I'm going to come back to make projects, but mostly I am more interested about the idea of how to make good projects, projects that doesn't give you only money, but give you meaning, projects that give value to the cities, and projects that contribute to reinvent the cities again. So thank you.
Vicente, thank you very much. That was a very, very enriched talk. I can't actually describe it adequately because there was so much there, and you gave it with such great aplomb. I don't think you took breath once. I think you did very well.
One
breath. That's I've been asked to sort of at the end of Vicente's lecture to us to try and sort of summarise what we've just seen, but I'm not going to try and do that. I'm going to do something else. I want to talk about ideas. And we've seen plenty of opportunities for ideas up on the screen before us. And we all have ideas. But I want to just pose the idea that ideas are worthless. Ideas themselves have no currency. An idea itself is just something that you have. What this Vicente has been showing is innovation, which is what you do with ideas. You actually take ideas and you make them innovative. You transform. You actually change the city. You change the ideas and the concepts of what urbanism might be. This is partly because ideas and innovation have strength in their own right, but then again, that is not sufficient. What you have to do with innovation and ideas is have to be able to sell. You have to have a narrative. You have to have the capacity to be an entrepreneur of innovation. And I think that's a word that was coming to mind when I was trying to think about what you were able to do so fantastically within a very short period of time. Part of that sort of capacity to sell comes through some analogies, and you started with the analogies of landscape and mountains, but then those analogies turned to graphics and sort of the narrative and the way that you could not just tell a story, you were actually making the story around the innovation and the ideas. And that's what gave what such great power and great currency. And so what I think we're seeing is sort of a capitalism of innovation, where innovation is something which is marketable. And you've seemed to be able to make it so in Barcelona, and that's an amazing feat. And so thank you very much for the lecture today. Before you start clapping, we just want to say that tomorrow at 12 p.m, Vicente has been able to sort of be available for questions for anyone who's able to come and join us in the Japanese room on the fourth floor. So students and anyone else who might be interested is certainly welcome to come along and engage in a further discussion with Vicente. Now you can clap. Thank you. Thank you very much.